Mrs. Sharael Taha.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, for letting me be a part of this debate. Minister Iswaran stated in a June 2020 article that electric cars accounted for 8.4% of all new car registrations in the first 5 months of this year. Sorry, let me repeat that. Minister Iswaran stated in a June 2022 SD article that electric cars accounted for 8.4% of all new cars registration in the first 5 months of this year, more than twice the rate in all of 2021. Compared to the whole of 2022, just 2 years ago, the 8.4% represents a 20-fold jump. To support this growth, the government has already set to boost Singapore's charging network. 2,000 public housing car parks equipped with electric vehicle chargers by 2025 and a network of 60,000 chargers by 2030. Just last week, on the 18th of November, Singapore has accepted the United States' invitation to join the collective 2030 zero emissions vehicle deployment goal, which represents a shared aspiration among like-minded countries in transiting to a greener land transport sector at the 2022 United Nations Climate Change Conference. To support our ambition of being environmentally responsible and lowering emissions from our land transport, we must create an efficient, economical, and effective EV charging ecosystem. Hence, I have a few clarifications to make for the Minister. Firstly, in regulating the safe charging of EVs to minimise the proliferation of unregulated or ill-maintained chargers which can pose safety hazards, the bill will provide LTA with powers to regulate the supply, modification, advertisements, installation, certification, registration, use and maintenance of EV chargers. The bill will require all chargers in Singapore to be installed, certified and used in accordance with prescribed standards such as registering before they can be used. Registered chargers will need to be inspected regularly in accordance with the relevant standard. Hence, I'd like to make a few clarification points. Does this apply to chargers already installed? What is the frequency and the cost of this routine inspection? Understandably, the LTA is responsible for EV chargers in public spaces, but is LTA also responsible for overseeing the upkeep of EV chargers in condo, residences and private offices? Will LTA be adequately resourced in terms of both personnel and capability to carry out such an activity? This involves having personnel with the necessary technical expertise to monitor and manage the supply and modification of EV chargers. With 60,000 public chargers across, not including chargers in office building, condos, landed homes, what is the expected manpower requirement and how do we ensure LTA is sufficiently resourced to carry out this enforcement? Is the Ministry concerned that the FCOs may detrimentally affect the grid and that adequate safeguards are in place to prevent that from happening? Is LTA best equipped to comprehend and monitor its effects, or should EMA also be involved too? Secondly, in order to provide a satisfactory user experience, the public charging network must be reliable. The bill requires EV charging operators to obtain a license in order to provide the service. Licensees will be required to meet conditions such as data exchange, the purchase of public liability insurance, and the uptime of the chargers in the network. Licensees will be valid for a fixed period and must be renewed. Hence, I would like to raise a few clarifications. What kind of information must the FCO share? How can we ensure the user's privacy is protected? How is the service uptime determined? And what is the expected penalty for not meeting service uptime? With multiple charging firms now offering varied pricing models, how do we ensure that the price structure is fair for customers, particularly penalty charges for leaving a fully charged EV in an EV lot? Thirdly, the bill will mandate developers or specified building works to provide EV charging at their developments. How do we maximise the efficiency of the charging infrastructure network? At present, we have SP Group, Shell Recharge, Blue Charge, Charge Plus, CDG NG, PlugShare, all with their own standards, own apps, own location, and charging speeds. In the long term, as more electric vehicles become available, demand for ICE vehicles will also fall, as will demand for pumps at gas stations. What is the strategy for gradually repurposing land for petrol stations and the labour that backs it up? How do we ensure that the transition from ICE to EV vehicles is done in a manageable way for both labour and land? One other topic that I would like to touch on is the recycling of batteries. Though this bill doesn't talk about recycling of car batteries, we will start to see many of our hybrid vehicles, like the Honda Vezel, Toyota Prius, reaching their 10th year and will be deregistered and sent for scrap soon. How are we prepared for scrapping, particularly the recycling of lithium-ion batteries in hybrid and electric vehicles? In Singapore, what percentage of scrap electric or hybrid vehicles had their batteries removed and recycled? Is the government working on regulations to ensure that hybrid and electric vehicles are recycled efficiently? Mr. Speaker, in Malay, please. Bagi penyokong pertumbuhan kenderaan elektrik atau EV pada tahun yang akan datang, pihak pemerintah sudah pun bertekad untuk membangunkan rangkaian pengecasan di Singapura. Dengan sebanyak 2,000 tempat letak kereta di estate perumahan bakal dilengkapi dengan pengecas EV menjelang 2025 dan sebanyak 60,000 pengecas menjelang 2030. Kami mempunyai aspirasi untuk memelihara alam sekitar dan mengurangkan pelepasan karbon dari kenderaan kita. Singapura seharusnya membangunkan ekosistem pengecasan EV yang berdaya tahan dan berkesan. Oleh itu, saya mempunyai beberapa pertanyaan. Pertama, adakah LTA yang akan bertanggungjawab bagi pengecas di tempat-tempat private seperti kondominium dan bangunan pejabat? Apakah kemungkinan di mana EFCO boleh menjejas grid elektrik dan bagaimanakah kita boleh mengelakkan kejadian itu daripada berlaku? Kedua, untuk memastikan perkhidmatan yang memuaskan, apakah penalti yang akan dikenakan kepada pengguna yang meletak kereta mereka di lot pengecas pada tempoh yang terlalu lama? Bagaimanakah kita dapat memastikan bahawa struktur harga pengecas adalah adil dan berpatutan bagi para pengguna? Memandangkan juga permintaan bagi pam di stesen minyak akan turun apabila Singapura beralih kepada kenderaan elektrik, apakah rancangan untuk membantu pekerja-pekerja di stesen minyak beralih ke sektor-sektor lain? Akhir sekali, walaupun rang undang-undang ini tidak membincangkan tentang pengitaran semula bateri kereta, kebanyakan kenderaan hybrid kami akan mencapai tahun ke-10 mereka dan akan dihantar untuk pelupusan. Bagaimanakah kita dapat mengitar semula bateri lithium-ion dalam kereta hybrid dan elektrik? Adakah pemerintah sedang mengkaji undang-undang untuk memastikan bahawa kenderaan hybrid dan elektrik boleh dikitar semula dengan cekap dan mampan? Notwithstanding the points of clarification, Mr. Speaker, sir, I support the bill. Thank you.